Okay, I'd like to call to order the regular council afternoon meeting for Monday, November 28th, 2022. Corporate officer, any late items? No late items. So if I could get approval of the agenda, please. Councillor Van Elfen, Councillor Betts, all in favor? That carries. And then item 4.1, to consider adoption of the November 14th minutes. Councillor Van Elfen, Councillor Betts, all in favor? That carries. And we'll go straight into delegations. And we have Paul Adams and Colin Moss from the Rural Health BC. And I'll just turn it over to you, gentlemen. They're on Zoom. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Worship. Can everybody hear us okay on your end?
Yes, we can. Yep.
Great. So I have a short PowerPoint presentation with audio, which is 5 minutes. And then we'll open up to any questions that you may have.
Sounds great. Go ahead.
Everyone should see a picture of my granddaughter, and following that, the presentation should come right up.
Yeah, please proceed.
Sorry, are you not getting any audio or visual on your end?
We have the visual. We're not hearing you.
You're not hearing me. Sorry, just 1 second. Sure, rural health equity is realized and we are a collective of individuals. Thank you, Your Worship, and honorable members of council for the opportunity to meet with you today. I am presenting today from the Upper Similkameen and the traditional territory of the Silks First Nation, home to the Upper Similkameen Indian Band and just outside the community of Princeton, BC. We have come today to request your membership in our network to help increase the voice of rural residents on their health and well-being. We are in a healthcare crisis, and increasing our voice is critical to ensure rural health equity is realized and stabilized throughout our province. The impacts of not addressing rural healthcare affects everyone. It is time to address the unique nature of rural challenges, which require rural-specific solutions. We are a collective of individuals, rural health advocacy groups, rural volunteers, rural healthcare providers, rural research groups, and nonprofits who provide rural programming and support. The group originally formed as a collective of local advocacy groups who championed rural health during the centralization of services. We have grown, and we are growing rapidly. Our purpose is to share successful strategies in an effort to address rural healthcare concerns. We advocate for policy changes that provide all rural residents with attachment to a healthcare practitioner. We identify areas of research aimed at improving access to healthcare in rural communities and provide fertile ground for research to take place. We inform the Ministry of Health in regards to rural healthcare concerns and recommend solutions to the improvement of services to rural BC residents. We work in partnership with other provincial organizations to influence policy change that improve access to healthcare services. We recognize the healthcare concerns of Indigenous communities and include their issues and concerns as part of our work. And we improve access to mental health services and addiction support services. We promote patient-centered community-based primary healthcare reform. We are a conduit of communication. We listen to our membership and the general public and hear about community-level challenges. We transfer knowledge to our membership and the general public from trusted sources. We also transfer knowledge from the membership and the general public to governments. And we provide local and regional solutions to authorities through high-level interaction with policymakers. We inform the grassroots of our communities, our volunteers, our hospice workers, our community services, and generally work to improve the recognition of rural healthcare providers. Community volunteers are the backbone of the BC Rural Health Network. We advocate for equity in health outcomes for all British Columbians, for the ability to live in place in rural BC, for a robust public healthcare system, for science-based management and solutions, and for community-centric care and community-based health management teams. We are apolitical, we are solutions-based, and we are a registered charity. We are here today to ask for you to join us. Your community voice is needed and wanted by our network. As the saying goes, once you've visited one rural community in BC, you have visited one rural community in BC. Each community in rural BC is unique and has its own unique problems and solutions. We cannot champion each individual problem faced, but we can find common areas that will improve health and wellness for many rural communities. Rural residents are resourceful and resilient, and we have solutions to offer. With a louder voice, we will ensure we are not just listened to, but heard. So with that, I would like to thank you all for your time. And if you have any questions, we are happy to answer them.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. Council, any questions? Councillor Trainer.
Thank you, Paul, for your presentation. Would you be able to provide an example of something that you're working on right now, just so we could kind of learn a little bit more about exactly what you're doing?
Yeah, so
we're
involved in a number of initiatives. We are on regular meetings with the executive of the Interior Health Authority. We get quarterly presentations from the BC Emergency Health Services. Leanne Heppel, Chief Ambulance Officer, comes and presents to our board, and we interact there. We formed an implementation committee a couple of months ago, and that's under the chair and leadership of Dr. Jude Cornelson, who is lead researcher out of the Rural Research Center at UBC. That committee has attracted broad support and participation from both members and non-members. And that committee is creating position papers for the BC Rural Health Network, which we then take action upon. And we're getting a lot of press time. We've been aired across the national news, as well as done the full gauntlet of CBC radio shows, Global TV, and others on positions that we do develop and present as solutions to government. Our initial policy position paper has been on community involvement in healthcare decision making. And that has attracted meetings with most recently Minister Cullen, but also Minister Conroy with Raleigh Russell on rural affairs. And we have an upcoming meeting with the NDP Rural Caucus, and hopefully shortly with Minister Dix as well. And again, we've taken an organization which has been growing organically and put a lot of focus on it on the last 12 months. And we're now seeing a huge increase in our membership and support. And we've seen a very significant rise in our municipal membership since we've started on this most recent campaign. And we now enjoy 18 rural communities that have joined us as municipal members, and that list grows frequently, weekly at this point.
Thank you. That's good. Councillor Betts.
Thank you. I was going to ask how many municipalities are currently included, and you said 18. Could I ask, please, the average size of the municipalities joining your group at this time?
So they can be, Colin is here from the village of New Denver, would be one of the smaller communities, but we have larger communities throughout BC. So I'll just run you through the list of current members. We have Burns Lake, Castlegar, Dawson Creek, Enderby, Fort St. James, Golden, Caslow, and Area D, Nacusp, New Denver, Oliver, Radium Hot Springs, Sycamusen District, Silverton, Slocan, Sun Peaks Municipality, Terrace, and Tofino.
And just with a follow-up, what is the end goal of having the municipalities included in your advocacy group?
So it's an umbrella organization. So we're wanting to increase our represented voice. So, you know, we're not looking at championing individual community issues. We're looking at overarching issues which impact all rural residents. So just increasing the number of residents that we represent through your municipality, and then opening up our organization to your municipal members if they so choose to get involved. We certainly would be happy to include you in our implementation committee. Colin is looking, and I'll let Colin speak a little bit more to municipal engagement, but you know, looking to form a municipal committee itself as our membership grows, and was just focused right now on getting additional members, and then we will circle back to the creation and formation of a committee specifically for our municipal membership. And we're also reaching out. Again, the broader the represented voice, the better. So we're working with regional districts. We've got TNRD and West Kootenay Regional District as meetings in the works, and another 25 regional districts that we will be looking to discuss the opportunity for their membership as well, and also reaching out within Indigenous communities and trying to increase our represented voice there. So really, it's a matter of wanting to have Summerland residents as being part of our represented voice.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Peake.
Thank you very much, Your Worship. My question is, what is your expectation from the communities that join as members? What do you want us to be working with, and how to do that?
So we found that through our presentations, there seems to be two different camps in how municipalities want to look at health. Either, it's not as simple as two, but just to simplify it, it seems to be two major positions. One is, we don't want to deal with health, and we want, we're happy for you to represent us on non-controversial overlapping issues. And so we're happy to be a member and not participate. And the other is the active communities that want to engage directly in healthcare planning and decision making and put their input. And again, for those communities, we're going to invite you in, and you're more than welcome to participate in our committees. If you have one representative on council who wants to be the spokesperson for health, it's that conduit and the communication piece where we're hearing from municipal members. We're hearing what the problems are within your communities. We're looking at those areas where we can find commonality, and we're championing those causes. So involvement is to the discretion of the municipality, but as a member, you're certainly entitled and desired to be involved directly in the work that we do. Into actual requirements for membership, we're asking for the a annual membership fee of $50. So we're not looking to make a financial gain off of the joining of your municipality to our group. We're looking to represent people on common issues.
Could I have a follow-up? Thank you. My other question being is that in the process, how do you identify what issues would be brought forward through this group?
So as I mentioned, we have an implementation committee, which is steering the board in the direction to where we see commonality. And again, community involvement in decision-making has been an initial position, a next position. We have a meeting actually coming up this week on the Thursday of the implementation committee. And the second item being brought forward is out-of-pocket expenses for travel for rural residents. And again, we're a non-controversial group, so we're not looking at extremes in anywhere. We're not a protest organization. We look at bringing solutions to the table and interacting in a positive way with authorities, so both at the health authority level and with the Ministry of Health and with other government agencies as is fit. And, you know, equity in health outcome for all residents in BC is the ultimate goal, so that we all have, you know, if you encounter a medical issue and you live rurally, that you can expect to have a similar outcome to somebody who lives in an urban environment. And as we progress and move forward, we'll, you know, we'll mark off more of those items on the list. But again, as a charitable organization and as a group that is looking to provide solutions, not just complain about problems, we really see that there is a need across rural BC to be heard on these issues, which are impacting so many people.
Thank you. I appreciate the outline, and I can see where vulnerable parts of our communities could benefit from the kind of advocacies that could come out of this.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Van Alphen.
Thank you, Mayor Holmes. My question was answered. It was regarding the fee, the membership fee. Thank you.
No other question. I have a question, if I may. How do you define rural?
This is the magic question, I guess. Nobody seems to be able to define rural. People do define it. According to the Medical Services Plan of BC, everybody in Northern British Columbia is rural, including Prince George. You know, in the same regard, the only people in the interior of British Columbia who are considered rural in the southern interior is my community, and Princeton being the distance to Penticton as being the tipping point. But then again, people who live on the outskirts of a community that could be quite urban, like Richmond, may consider themselves rural. So we don't tend not to try to define rural as much as we do to the needs of rural. So you know, it becomes a problem for everybody to try and specify exactly what rural means. And we're just happy to champion the cause of people who consider themselves rural residents. You know, I think every issue that we encounter, the benefit will not just be to rural residents, but also to our urban populations and neighbors, because the downstream effect of not allowing people to be able to live in place and not having the fundamental services they need to exist from a health point of view in some areas of the province have a trickle-down effect to all communities, big and small.
So I guess my frustration is the ministry doesn't consider Summerland a rural community. They kind of lump us in with Penticton and we're considered a urban community with it. And this creates barriers for us to access programs such as the Rural Primary Care Network, for example. And so we're fighting this uphill battle to be recognized as a rural community, you know, with the ministry. And I imagine the your organization is would be quite supportive of something like the rural primary care network and the funding that's going to that. But we're sitting outside that, looking in. So how would your group deal with a situation like that?
And again, we don't have an immediate solution for anybody, unfortunately. Our recent meeting with Minister Cullen, we had representation from the Ministry of Health on there, and they did allude to primary care networks as being the tool that the ministry sees as being the one that is doing the communication between residents and the government. We disagreed with that, just again, because people aren't necessarily attached to a primary care network, and even the ones that are attached to a primary care network don't actually often know that they're attached. So that initial policy position piece on community-centric, community-involved decision-making comes into play. And that would be something, again, we would look to your community and to others of similar size and start to put the position in place for the types of communities like your own. And I can say, on living on the other end of the Princeton Summerland Road, that there is a lot of residents who are definitely rural residents who are part of your jurisdiction, and we certainly see that. We cannot fight for one individual cause, but I think that is a type of scenario which is going to apply to many mid-sized communities and that have relatively close proximity to larger centers, and something that we would definitely bring up through our implementation committee into action.
Okay, thank you. Any further questions? I don't see any. So thank you, gentlemen. We'll be in touch, I guess.
We appreciate that. I don't know if Colin wanted to add anything from a municipal perspective, as he is a councillor over with the village of New Denver, and recognizes some of the other economic challenges involved with health.
Sure. Good afternoon, Mayor and Council. I don't want to take up too much of your time. I think Paul has said most everything. About 6 ago, our fire chief and myself, I was then chair of the Chamber of Commerce Health Committee. We mobilized the community to save our ER and get involved in physician recruitment. And along the way, we realized that we'd be much more effective as elected officials. So 4 years ago, the fire chief ran for mayor, I ran for councillor. We were both elected. We've both been reelected to our second term. And along the way, we realized how important it is for a municipality to be involved, or a municipal council to be involved in its local healthcare situation, both from a individual citizen perspective and also the economic health of their community. And we all know why. I won't get into that. But our hope is, as we get more municipal councils and regional districts signed on as members, we will form a committee, a municipal regional district committee, where we hear from municipalities like your own that bring problems, possible solutions, recommendations that we can bring to our implementation committee. And the bigger municipal regional district voice we have, obviously, the more we're going to be listened to. We have other types of membership. We have hospice societies, chambers of commerce, NavCare volunteers, seniors, mental health organizations. So we're not just municipal oriented, but it's just a case of the larger voice we have, the more we're going to be listened to. So I could talk for hours on this one, but it's obviously dear to our hearts. And I do believe there is a place for elected representatives on the board representing their municipalities. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Corporate officer, should we have a motion to receive for information? And yeah, okay. Councillor Peake? Yeah. Okay, second. Councillor Van Elfen, all in favor? Thank you. And then we'll refer this to our CAO and talk about it later. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you,
have gentlemen. A good day.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Move on to item 6, public comment opportunity. Is there anybody online, corporate officer? No, nobody online. Business items. Community organization storage containers on municipal property. And I'll turn this over to our management of procurement.
Good afternoon, Mayor and Council. So we received a request from the Summerland Rotary Club to request permission to place a storage container at 911 Peach Orchard Road, which is directly adjacent to the Summerland Arena. It's just off of the road or driveway that runs through that property. The container includes supplies required to operate the Sunday market, Christmas lights, and Canadian flags with poles and anchors. The district has previously allowed the Rotary Club to place a shipping container at that location during two previous Sunday market seasons prior to COVID. And the Rotary Club is aware that they might be unable to continue to use that site if the recreation center is approved for construction at 882 Jubilee, but they would appreciate the use of the central location in the meantime. They also have a small trailer parked on the east side of the arena, so on the 8820 Jubilee Road property, and we feel that the trailer should also be included in the license of occupation. So when we were looking into this matter, it also came to our attention that the Summerland Fall Fair and Summerland Healthcare Auxiliary Society have storage containers placed in the northeast area of the arena property without formal agreements in place. So we would recommend formalizing arrangements with these two organizations by entering into licenses of occupation for them as well. The agreements would outline the terms and conditions of their use, including required insurance, and they would also provide records of the arrangements so that future staff would be able to locate the records of what the arrangement was, who to contact if we have any questions or concerns or issues, so on and so forth. So the Summerland Fall Fair indicated that their storage container contains props, signage, tents, stage stairs, Pioneer Workshop tools, and vendor dividers for use at the Summerland Fall Fair. And the Healthcare Auxiliary Society indicated that they use their storage containers to store bags of unusable donated clothing and textiles. And then once that container is full, the items are hauled to a processor in the lower mainland. The fabric is then processed and recycled, and this generates income for the society. So they generate approximately $12,000 a year through that initiative, and that also keeps the clothing and textiles out of our landfill. So staff note that the community organizations benefit from being able to place the storage containers on our property at little or no cost, and that the district does not currently require the land for other purposes. We also confirmed with our Director of Development Services that there aren't any issues from a zoning or planning perspective to have the storage containers placed on the arena property. Should Council be comfortable allowing not-for-profit organizations to place storage containers on municipally owned property, on a future basis, staff would recommend that the arrangements be approved on a case-by-case basis. So we recommend entering into license of occupation agreements for a nominal fee of $1 per year, just to set out the terms and conditions of the license, including insurance. The terms and conditions would be similar to the Rotary Club's 2018 license of occupation, which was included with the report as attachment number 2. However, unlike the license attached to the report, we propose a term of the agreement for 3 years with the option to extend for 3 additional years and the ability for the district to terminate the license for any reason on 30 days notice. So we're proposing a term of 3 years just to reduce the administrative overhead associated with the arrangements and, you know, coming back to council with reports and circulating for signature and tracking expirations. but we would still have the option to terminate. So that should be adequate for our purposes if we require the land for other reasons. And we just note that a license of occupation doesn't grant exclusive use of the property, nor does it grant an interest in the property itself. And therefore, it's not considered a disposal of property like a sale or a lease would be, and doesn't require public notification in accordance with the community charter. So that concludes my report, and I'll open up the floor if you have any questions.
Okay, thank you. Council, any questions? Councillor Peak.
I appreciate the detail in the report, Dana. And I want to say that this is exactly the kind of agreements that would make possible to support our community organizations. And it's a good way to be doing it. They supply a lot of what we need in the community that we couldn't do ourselves. So a three-year arrangement and with a renewal possible or other contingency plans being made if that's needed is exactly what I see making it work properly. Thank you very much.
Okay, Councillor Peak, since you're in favor, would you like to bring forward a motion?
Yeah.
You don't have to read it out.
No, I'll bring forward the resolution that is here with our report.
Okay, awesome. Seconder, Councillor Van Elfen. Any further discussion? I'll call the question. All in favor? Any opposed? That carries. Thank you very much, Dana. Next item, update on the local government climate action program, and I'll ask our sustainability coordinator to present.
Good afternoon, Council and Mr. Mayor. So my name's Odessa. I'm the sustainability coordinator. For the folks that are new and haven't met me yet, I started here about a year ago, and I have a master's in resource and environmental management, and I'm a registered planner. Hopefully we'll cross paths and collaborate on many climate-related projects in the future. For this report here, staff is asking council to pass the resolution to update on the local government climate action report from the sustainability coordinator dated November 28th, 2022, and to be received for information. So for those of you who had been part of the CARET program or the Climate Action Revenue Incentive Program, this had run for about a decade through the province of BC and provided funding through any signatories of the BC Climate Action Charter, and that included Summerland. And we received funding between $30,000 and $40,000 each year every time we registered and submitted our corporate emission reporting. Unfortunately, last year, they decided to fold the program and they brought in the LGCAP program called the Local Government Climate Action Program. So this is replacing CAREP. It's got a few revisions and changes as a way to meet the needs of all those BC signatories. So the information today is just summarizing what the LGCAP program is, what that means for the district, and moving forward, how we can take advantage and fully implement the changes into the rest of our policy and work. So for the LGCAP program, the biggest difference is that it incorporates both community and corporate emissions, whereas before the CARE program was previously just addressing corporate emissions. As well, it is also looking now at adaptation or climate action impacts. So things like flooding, wildfires, heat waves, how we address that, either through building improvements, community awareness, things that help us adapt to those changes. And as they've also provided more funding to these communities. They've revamped their distribution funding assessment. So they've changed how much we get based off of our population. So as of August 31st, we received $120,000+ from the province, and that went directly into our climate action reserve. That climate action reserve is an account that is fed from all of the funds that we've been receiving from CAREP and now the LGCAP program. So that has been deposited and is sitting there, planned for future implementation for projects. With that being said, because the LGCAP program is slightly different in its objectives and goals compared to the CAREP program, and we've also approved, or council has approved since the original development of the climate action policy, which helps direct staff and council on how to spend and disperse the funds to different climate projects that help meet the goals of the provincial program, as well as our own climate initiatives. We are needing to update that policy so that it takes into account our corporate and community-based emission and energy management or reduction plans, as well as the changes in the scope and scale of the LGCAP program. So that'll be coming to council in the new year, most likely in quarter one, for review, as it's already been drafted and reviewed by staff and other departments internally. Otherwise, staff have worked closely with the province in order to meet the requirements for the LGCAP program, submitting a survey and posting our attestation on our public webpage under the Climate Action Program. So staff at this point have met all the requirements. We've been formally integrated into the LGCAP program. And at this point, we are just waiting on that policy to be further amended once we bring it back to council. So in conclusion, the new LGCAP program is providing the district with additional funds to continue working towards provincial and local government goals of climate action. The program is expanding climate action initiatives to include both corporate and community emission reduction and adaptation to climate hazards and events. Thank you.
Thank you, that's good news. Any questions? Councillor Peak.
Thank you, Chair. My question is, with the expanded program, does that give the opportunity for more projects to be funded because they now include the community and adaptation and not just the corporation?
Through the chair, so yes, that does mean that we can actually further expand some of our initiatives. That's correct, because we are now looking at adaptation, but also at community-based adaptation and emission. Those funds can be dispersed once we have the policy amended through council, if they so choose to agree with all my amendments.
Councillor Trainer.
I'm sorry if I missed this. I'm just going to ask for clarification. So for the community section, well, that just, is that still tied to emissions, or can it be like other climate adaptation projects?
Through the chair, yes, that is correct. So it's both emission based and adaptation based, because the LGCAP program has formally recognized that we need to address adaptation. It also includes reference to the Clean BC Roadmap to 2030, which is emission based, and the recently published it's a long title. It's the adaptation strategy for BC that was just recently promoted and approved. So that's 2022 and that's included.
Okay, that's really good to hear, because before it was pretty limited. So I'm really happy to hear that they've recognized that there's much more we can do for climate change. So thanks.
Does the government have its own criteria of how we can spend the money, or is it just whatever we have in our own policy?
Apologies, I left my microphone on there. Not technically, it does give us those broad goals and objectives that we have to meet in order to spend it, but the specification as to how much we dedicate to either corporate or community-based and adaptation and mission, as long as we meet the overarching federal and provincial targets and goals, we kind of have that freedom at this point to just say, this is how much we want to dedicate and to what types of projects. So I provide some possible amendments to address that.
Thank you. Any further questions? And just out of curiosity, how much do we have in the reserve right now? Do you know offhand?
I did not get that number. I apologize. No, I don't have the number at the top of my head.
That's okay. Thanks. Councillor Van Alphen.
Move the staff recommendation, Mr. Mayor.
Bring forward for information. Thank you. Seconder, Councillor Betts, all in favor? Any opposed? That carries. Thank you. Next item, 7.3, the BC Tourism Grant Application, and this was for the Director of Community Services.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Good afternoon, Council. The purpose of this report is for council to consider supporting the submission of a grant application to BC Tourism to obtain $1 million to cover the cost to design and rebuild the Summerland Kiwanis Pier at Gordon Beggs Rotary Beach. BC Tourism's Destination Development Fund, Stream 1, will provide financial support for up to $1 million per project to build or rejuvenate tourism infrastructure, visitor amenities, and tourist attractions. No matching funds are indicated as being required. As noted in the recently presented Summerland Waterfront Concept Plan report, the Kiwanis Pier replacement is indicated as a high priority item that has significant cost implications, which is costed out right now between $750,000 and $1 million. The pier replacement is included in the five-year capital plan, and as it has been assessed to be in poor condition at the end of its lifespan. The pier is currently closed for a structural assessment, and we're still awaiting the results of that. I connected with BC Tourism on Friday to gain a little bit more insight about the program and input on to how we could strengthen our application for this particular project. And they felt that this project was a really good one. They felt it has regional value and that there are very few piers on Okanagan Lake right now, and it is definitely an attraction for tourism to our community. So they really liked the project and the concept, and they think it's an important piece of infrastructure or amenity that we have. The downside is they did indicate that because we currently have funding, we've received funding for our outdoor washroom project. It is from the same funding pot from tourism, and we haven't completed that project. So we will, that will have an impact on the scoring of our application. And it really depends on the number and quality of applications that they get in by December 7th, which is the cutoff. But she did indicate that she felt that we should continue with submitting an expression of interest because they did like the project. So it's a very quick turnaround as far as the application process. We submit by December 7th. They will be shortlisting, they're hoping, before Christmas and getting back to communities the beginning of January for if you've made the shortlist and to submit a full application, and they hope to have agreements in place with communities that are successful by the end of March. And we have until March 31st, 2025 to complete the project. So the staff recommendation as presented is to support staff completing the EOI and to obtain funding for the pier. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions? Councillor Barkwell.
So that pier is pretty heavy duty. I think it's originally designed for railway cars, and to rebuild it to what it was before would be to overbuild it, I think. Could there be in this plan to build a pier similar in maybe size, and but also that is not going to cost $1 million, so a bit of that money could be spent on some of the things shown in the waterfront concept plan, such as a swing out into the water and whatever, you know, surface amenities that it doesn't have now. Can that be part of the submission, just at a minor improvements, I guess you might call it?
Thank you for the question through Mr. Mayor. The intention for the expression of interest and would be to reference the waterfront concept plan and what they've have recommended in there, and with that comes those amenities and extras, and that's where the budget of $750 to $1 million came out, is to add those amenities included in the project. As far as how it's structurally built, I don't know if there's any cost savings to have it, you know, I think the same size and the distance is what was recommended from the community, but I don't know, if the Director of Works of Infrastructure can comment on any cost savings with the actual base structure.
I think you'd use modern materials instead of, you know, 2x4x8 planks and such would be a fortune now.
Yes, through the mayor, that's absolutely right. Is we would use more current materials for rebuilding it, and we would also go into the project with an intended purpose. This is not going to be for holding vehicles or holding that sort of thing. It's just for pedestrian use. That said, it does have to be built for high water levels, wave action during those high water levels, which takes your high water mark and adds 2 feet on top of it. So it will be a robust structure at the end of the day. But we can definitely look at what we're looking to design it to.
Thank you. Councillor Trainer.
With regards to the other project, the washrooms that they gave us funding for, did they indicate that might be an issue because we've already gotten funding before or because of the project's not complete yet?
If through the mayor, to the deputy mayor, they indicated that it has an impact if it's not completed in the funds spent by December 31st of this year.
Was that were we supposed to have it done? Was that part of their
no? So the original
they didn't put a completion date on the when we had to have it spent.
Okay. So that intake of the funding stream that was March 31st, 2023 was a requirement, and they've actually extended it to March 31st, 2024. So we have that much amount of time in order to complete that project. So these projects are overlapping.
Okay. Yeah. So I think this is a really great opportunity to apply for funding for a project that I think would really benefit us. Your experience of writing grant applications, but I think if you just emphasize that we are really grateful that we already got that funding for the other project and that it's underway and we're anticipating on completing it very soon, and that this project would complement that one. Just trying to, you know, please them and let them know that we're very thankful for what they already gave us, but that this is also an important project. Yeah, thanks.
Councillor Betts.
Thank you, through the mayor. My question actually is, I've been reading about another, I think, a steamboat operator who has been talking about doing tours around the lake between Penticton and Summerland and possibly Naramata. Is the new dock design designed to allow for that kind of boat to come to Summerland? Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah. Through the mayor to Councillor Betts, I'm assuming you're talking about the Fintry Queen, which is council has received a presentation on that earlier this year. The current design does not include considerations for having a large boat come and dock at it. It could, but the current designs don't, and the operator of the Fintry Queen was considering another location for a pier and recognized that the current pier is used for a lot of activity and kids jumping off it and activity. So he thought that might be a conflict. So he was looking at other locations. But if this is a priority of council to look at that project to dovetail, then we could look at it. But at this point, the current designs does not include that.
Yeah. Any further questions? Councillor Barkwell?
Yeah, on these grant applications and such, the amount that we contribute makes a difference. On this one, that said that we weren't, you know, expected to, but nevertheless, when we are contributing, and I was thinking of the $150,000 we budgeted for electrical, for the washroom upgrades in the utility budget, I think that you know, it should be mentioned as a point in our favor, small point maybe, but still it's a big contribution for that.
Councillor Peake. Certainly.
Do you want me to read?
No, you just say as a, to support the
peer.
Yeah, application. Yeah. Second by Councillor Trainer. Any further discussion? Call the question. All in favor? That carries. 7.4, council remuneration policies, corporate officer.
Thank you, Chair Holmes. So before council are the remuneration policies that have been amended with previous council direction. These amendments include increased meal expenses, that council remuneration be increased by 2% for 2023, that the annual CPI increase for council remuneration be paused for 2023, and that the task force reconvene in 18 months, so about December 2023, to review this increase, and that the district pay for 50% of the benefit premium for council members and the member paying, with the member paying the remaining 50%, and that the deputy mayor receive a monthly stipend of $600. And with that, I'm happy to take any questions.
Any questions? Councillor Trainer.
I think I'm going to remove myself from this vote just because there is a portion in it that references the deputy mayor, which is specific to me, whereas the other ones are more broad to all of council. So.
Okay. Councillor Van Alphen.
Like, I agree with everything. The only thing I'm having a real problem with is bullet C, that mayor and council be eligible to enroll in a benefit package and contribute 50% of the premiums. What's the rest of staff pay at the district for benefits?
So I believe, or through the chair to Councillor Van Alphen, I believe staff benefits are generally covered, the premium.
That's what I was thinking also, that their benefits are covered, but you want 50% of council members. So that's the only issue I have. Maybe that's for a later discussion, I don't know, but that's the only bullet point I don't agree with.
This was subject to quite a lengthy debate and discussion in several months ago, and the staff was just following the direction that council provided at that time.
So the second thought?
Yeah, well, there's lots I didn't agree with. But Councillor Barkman?
I think you just answered my question. I guess at the time our direction was to have staff prepare this, because I thought we'd already essentially made up our minds and agreed to all of these things, but now it's formalized, I guess.
Yeah. My understanding, yep. Councillor Peake, did you have any?
I'm going back in my head some other part of this I read. But in addressing what Councillor Van Alphen has said, when you're elected, it's a part-time position. The opportunity to have coverage may be considered a greater benefit, but perhaps it's unfair to say that if you're here for a short time, maybe you shouldn't be, you should have to pay 50%. Other people would say, well, we're here, your council is here for 4 years, they deserve the coverage that is available to the staff for the time that they're at council table. I can't find it in this report. There was something about putting a stop on the CPI until some other date. Is that some other motion?
Go ahead.
Through the chair to Councillor Peake. So in June 27th, 2022, council passed a series of resolutions that were recommended by the Remuneration Task Force, and they are just listed in the background of the RFD that's presented. So one of the recommendations was that the CPI increase for 2023 be paused so that the task force could reconvene in 18 months to review that increase against inflationary implications and the approaches taken by other municipalities in this next year.
Thank you for reiterating that. I just couldn't quite get to it in my head. I appreciate it.
Councillor Metz.
Sorry, I'm just looking to ask a question. So was the debate when it was going through Councillor Van Alphen, was it that you felt that our contributions, that council's contributions were deserving of a similar health account as staff?
Yes.
Yes, and I don't recall the 50% aspect. Maybe I wasn't here. I don't recall.
Okay, if there's no further questions, would somebody like to bring a motion forward? Councillor Buckwell?
I'll bring it forward as presented.
Okay, seconder, Councillor Peake. Any further discussion? I'll call the question. All in favor? 3-4. All opposed? 2 opposed. That motion carries. And I think we can bring Councillor Trainer back. There she goes. 7.5, Council Procedure Bylaw Amendments, Corporate Officer.
Thank you, Chair Holmes. Sorry, let me just pull up my notes quick. So before Council is the Council Procedure Amendment Bylaw Number 2022-014, incorporating the direction Council previously provided regarding the appointment of the Deputy Mayor, incorporation of a consent agenda, and changing council meetings to a 3-week rotation. The deputy mayor appointment, in accordance with council resolution on November 7th, 2022, will come into effect January 1st, 2023. The inclusion of the consent agenda, should the amendments be adopted, will occur at the first meeting of January 2023, and the 3-week rotation will begin starting March 13th, 2023. Should council provide the first 3 readings of the amending bylaw, notice that the council procedure bylaw is being amended must be issued in the paper prior to adoption. And additionally, staff will be bringing forward a deputy mayor protocol policy outlining the roles and responsibilities of the deputy mayor for council consideration at the December 12th meeting. And with that, I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you. Any questions? Councillor Patton.
Thank you, Your Worship. So I did send an email for the at the last meeting since I was not here, but I do have a bit of an issue with 3 weeks. If we're a municipality of choice for our builders and contractors, I could agree with it. If we were forward-thinking and solution-oriented in regards to our housing options and how we deal with our applications, I could agree with it. If our policies and procedures were created that were to include efficient processing, then I would agree with it. But honestly, I think that we're taking time away, a minimum of 2 weeks for any application. And unfortunately, I don't agree that 3 weeks is good for our residents, our contractors, or our builders. So I will leave it at that, but I will not be supporting this. Thank you.
Okay, any questions or comments? Councillor Peake.
Was this for a trial period? Are we reviewing this?
Through the chair to Councillor Peake, I believe that was council's intention, and bylaws can be reviewed at any time. So should council choose at the end of 2023 not to stick with it, we would just amend the bylaw again, go back to second and fourth or whatever dates council chooses.
Thank you.
I myself don't necessarily agree with you, Councillor Patton. I think combined with the delegating of the mining variances, which will actually speed up a lot of the applications that we get, because it won't even have to come to council. And secondly, when you have rezoning applications, for example, anything that requires a public hearing, we have to give 2 weeks notice, public notice for that, which does it. So if you have a council meeting and then you have another, that's why we always have our public hearings 4 weeks after it passes first reading before we can have a public hearing. Now you can have it at the next council meeting. So you're actually shorting by a week the ability to have a public hearing. So you can slice this many different ways. And at the end of the day, I don't think it will make a whole lot of difference. So I think this idea that the business, I've never heard of, you know, the number of meetings that you have, you know, is a measure of success for how much business you're able to accomplish. The business takes place between meetings. We need meetings to, so we know all what we're going to be doing and that we're all on the same page, but the work is done between the meetings. And this gives us more opportunity, more to do that work. That's the way I see it. And so, but as I say, there's different ways to look at it. So, Councillor Barkwell.
I guess I'd have to say, and I expressed at my time, I was a little bit skeptical, but I have been convinced that the overall result, I expect to be better. And if it's not, we'll know, and we make further revisions. But if you don't try new things, you'll never get anywhere. So we have to give it a whirl. Have to make an effort here.
Councillor Patton.
Thank you. I look forward to be proven wrong. Thank you.
Okay. No further discussion. Councillor Chenner.
I'll just add something as well. For me, the reason why I support this, and at the beginning, I didn't really like it either. I had to be convinced because I think, you know, the public expects us to meet every 2 weeks. But then after listening to the CAO and to staff, this gives them more time to prepare reports, particularly when there's holidays on Mondays. It backs, you know, it pushes forward everything, and then they have less time to do their work. And they got to write reports as well as do all of the work that they're directed to do. And so if this helps them, then I think we get better efficiency, and I think we get better products. I think we get better reports, and I think the productivity goes up. So that's why I was convinced. And so I'm willing to try it for a while. We'll see how it goes. If it doesn't work and we don't like it next January, we can change it back.
Councillor Alphin.
I appreciate what the deputy mayor is saying. So should the motion also say that will be reviewed in a 1 year period? Or is that just a given? Or should it be stated in the motion, or could we bring it back?
Through the chair to Councillor Van Elfen. So I've already kind of factored it into my work plan for 2023 to bring it back. But if council wants to put it in the motion, we could write it into the bylaw on a trial basis. I would maybe recommend not doing that. You could make a separate motion that the three-year quotation be reviewed on a trial basis or be reviewed at the end of 2023 if you want, but it is factored into our work.
Thank you.
I'd also say anybody can bring a notice of motion at any time to review anything. So Councillor Peake.
In consideration of the discussion that we had before, the reduction of meetings is only 18 meetings as opposed to 21. It's really a very small reduction. And with the opportunity to actually get those reports and the background work done in a more timely manner, I think that we may be improving it. So we'll see what happens. And to try new things is actually commendable as far as I'm concerned. Sometimes we get awfully set in our ways, especially in the government. So I think this opportunity is well worth it.
Thank you. Councillor Van Elfen.
No, I agree. I'm willing to try it. And 18 minutes versus or 18 meetings versus 21 meetings. I can't remember the number the CAO had told me once, but I believe we had 99 meetings last year. So that kind of tells you 18 to 21. Theoretically, we had 99 meetings, if you include closed meetings and committee of the whole and special meetings and budget meetings, add them all up. It's not like we're going to lose three meetings. So I look forward to trying it and see how it all works out. Thank you.
Okay. Would someone like to bring the motion forward? Okay. First three readings. Second, Councillor Traynor. Any further discussion? I'll call the question. All in favor? Any opposed? Councillor Patton's opposed. That carries. Thank you. Where are we at here now? The bylaws for adoption, 8.1, the financial plan, corporate officer.
Oh, let me just pull up my notes on this. So the financial plan amendment bylaw received its first three readings at the November 14th meeting and is now ready for adoption.
Okay, this is for adoption. Anyone like to bring that forward? Councillor Patton, seconder. Councillor Betts, any discussion? So no, all in favor? That carries. Public media comment period. Don't see anybody. Just everybody's leaving and they're not coming. So I'd like a resolution to close the meeting to the public. Councillor Van Alphen, Councillor Betts, all in favor? That carries.